Hello students, today I am going to discuss with all of you the chapter Coming Home to Delhi. This chapter is a personal essay and it is autobiographical in nature. It will introduce all of you to the contemporary form of writing. Coming Home to Delhi is written by Madhur Jaffre. She is an award-winning actress and best-selling cookery author. Her first book, An Invitation to Indian Cookery, was published in 1973, and her TV show Madhur Jaffre's Indian Cookery for the BBC made her a household name. She has appeared in over 20 films including Merchant Ivories, Heat and Dust, and written over 15 cookery books including Ultimate Curry Bible and Curry Easy. The chapter Coming Home to Delhi is a personal essay and it reads like the opening chapter of an autobiography in which the writer fondly fits the memory of a childhood in an extended family within the wider context of Delhi as the city in which she grew up. So children, let's begin the chapter Coming Home to Delhi. It is probably at dawn and dusk that Delhi offers the most beautiful part of itself. I remember as a child going away from Delhi and my grandfather's house on holidays to hill stations. When we returned, it was always a night journey by train. My mother would shake us awake as we neared the Yamuna River. Delhi lay just beyond it. Flocks of squawking mynahs and parrots would be circling the pink sky as the steam train traveled towards Delhi, and soon it was time for the morning tea. So children, let's look at the words dawn and dusk. Dawn is the time just before the sun rises, and dusk is the time just after the sun set, when sky turns almost crimson, and we could see a beautiful skyline with various shades of crimson, orange, gold and gray. So that is what we mean by dawn and dusk. Now let's look at the word squawking. Children, squawking here, in the morning time when sun rises, flocks of birds they fly and they make a very loud high-pitched chirping sound, and that's what is meant by the word squawking. So the writer has also through her words drawn a visual picture before our eyes. Flocks of squawking mynahs and parrots would be circling the pink sky. So a very beautiful picture of dawn, early morning, has been portrayed by the writer. So the paragraph we just read tells us that childhood memories never fade. We always remember the good memories. For example, if you might also remember your train journey with family whenever you would have gone for a vacation. So the writer describes Delhi in the early morning from her childhood memories of returning home to Delhi after holidaying on the hills. She makes us her co-traveler by enlisting each and every detail about the train journey. This autobiographical piece makes me realize that all of us have childhood memories, and some of them, pleasant ones of course, remain with us for life, and we want to share them with our loved ones. So the writer too has described her childhood memories, and she has written it so that others may also read it. Let's read the second paragraph. Tea was a simple affair. bought from vendors who marched up and down the train with large kettle chanting, "Hot tea, hot tea." It was served in terracotta cups that added to the sugary, milky tea a delicious flavor of their own. As soon as we had had our tea, my mother would pull out her purse and take from it a generous amount of coins. This was a sign that the train was about to go over the Yamuna Bridge. Each child, armed with a handful of coins, would choose a position by a window. We would take one coin at a time and hurl it on the holy currents of the Yamuna. If the coin hit the water, our mother told us, we would be blessed. If it hit a washerman beating clothes on a sandy island or the bridge, then no blessings could be expected. We would try to get our blessings as quickly as possible because the approaching city called for our full attention. With the sun raining gold on it, the domes and minarets of the 17th century Mughal capital looked like they might be in a miniature painting. So in this paragraph, the author described tea by calling it sugary, milky tea served in terracotta cups. Terracotta is a brownish red clay that has been baked and is used for making things such as cups, flower pots, and so on. The addition of terracotta cups to the tea gives it its characteristic flavor and appeals to our sense of sight and taste. The description of the sun raining gold on the domes and minarets of the city evokes an image of very bright, dazzling sunlight, which seems to make the spectacle before her look like a scene from a painting. In the last paragraph, which we just read, we saw how the writer transports us to her childhood days by stimulating her five senses. Her descriptions come alive by appealing to her sense of hearing, taste, sight, and touch. Hearing, flocks of squawking mynas and parrots would be circling the pink sky. Taste, a sense of taste is evoked by these lines. It was served in terracotta cups that added to the sugary milky tea a delicious flavor of their own. Sight, our sense of sight has been evoked by the line. With the sun raining gold on it, the domes and minarets of the 17th century Mughal capital looked like they might be in a miniature painting. This was my city. The city where I was born and the city of my ancestors. My heart invariably skipped a beat when I saw it. Invariably skipped a beat means heart always seemed to stop for a moment because of a sudden emotion. Delhi, India's capital city, is a combination of many Delhis. For the last 1,000 years, as rulers replaced each other, one Delhi was torn down to build another, often with the stones of its former self. One of Delhi's conquerors in the last millennium, the Mughals were known for their great wealth and taste. They built two cities, of which Shahjahanabad, now called the Old City, became famous throughout the ancient world as the seat of the Grand Mughal. Coming from distant places, these rulers longed for the food and climate of their home. They could do nothing about the weather, but they built gardens, water tanks, and canals. The Mughals carved marble canals that went through their palace bedrooms, and they ate their own food. As the years went by, some of their dishes were included and accepted as part of the city's local food. Persian-style pulaus that combine meat and rice, samosas, pakoris, and of course tea. At my grandfather's house, The men in my family learned Persian poetry and ate delicate kebabs. The women, though allowed some education, were kept at home for most of the time. When they played tennis, the entire court was cleared so that no one could see them dashing about in flowing saris and tennis shoes. On cold winter evenings, a wood fire was lit in the drawing room, where three benches stood in front of the fire. Here, the children, about two dozen of us, would sit playing word games. So the author, while describing Delhi's past, refers to the kings in particular who built forts, palaces, canals, and gardens to manifest their political power and also to recreate the climate in their of their native land that they pined for. They also introduced their food that eventually became part of the local cuisine. So in the last paragraph, we come to know that Delhi has been a witness to cultural amalgamation. In the essay, we know that Delhi is the writer's hometown and the home of her ancestors too. She sees Delhi as India's capital city. She sees her hometown also as the home of many ancient rulers who built and rebuilt the city according to their whims and tastes. She mentions the Mughals who tried to recreate their homelands by carving marble canals that passed through their palaces and introducing their own variety of food and tea. She writes with warmth as she describes her childhood in a big family with her grandfather as the head and depicts all little things that caught her attention as a child. So Delhi, in this chapter has been portrayed as the national capital and how different rulers influenced its architecture, food, literature and so on. She also portrays Delhi as a hometown and creates before us vivid images that she has seen and experienced in her childhood. She has seen men of her family learning Persian poetry and enjoying delicate kebabs, and how women of her family used to play tennis in flowing saris and tennis shoes. That was only after it was made sure that no one could watch them play. Let's read the next paragraph. Behind the benches was a circle of sofas and a large chair. It was from here that grandfather held court. He loved to lecture his grandchildren on Delhi's history, and his best opportunities came at family picnics. These were held in the winter or during the monsoon season in a well-tended garden of a 17th century tomb or a 12th century palace. The entire family would go on the picnic. During my childhood, it never occurred to me that families could come in sizes smaller than 30 people, swelling easily to few thousands at the mention of a wedding. Preparations for the picnic would begin early in the morning. Potatoes in a hot tomato sauce, golden puris, warm moist meatballs, and jars of pickles would be packed along with fruits in large baskets. Two cars would stand ready, gleaming in the sun. The art of getting 30 people into two cars had long been mastered. The first layer consisted of short ladies and teenagers. On their laps went the second layer, consisting of 10-12 years old. The third layer consisted of all those below the age of 10. The tall men sat in the front seat. On their laps sat the 10 to 12 year olds holding the basket and pots that could not be stuffed into the trunk. Once we reached the gardens of the Qutub Minar, the children would rush to climb the sandstone tower while the picnic was laid out on a large cotton sheet. Once we saw all the food laid out, He would thunder down the hundreds of steps, jostling and competing to get there first. The foods and places of my childhood can still be found in Delhi. Mornings still start in a haze of familiar smoke sent skyward by millions of stoves and cookers. In those early hours, potatoes and peas are combined with ginger, turmeric and green chilies. Chapatis are cooked over hot fires, buttered and steaked with the vegetables and peas and a piece of mango pickle in a tiffin carrier to be carried by many people on their way to school and offices, just as I did on my way to school in Delhi. So in the paragraph that we read just now, the author describes all the fun that she had in her childhood days as she was part of a big joint family. Family picnics, grandfather's court, delicious food and the art of accommodating in a big group are all described here. All of us as readers could easily visualize each details enlisted by her, and we could easily relate to what has been written by her. Golden puris, potato curry in hot tomato sauce, mango pickle, we all have certainly tasted them. The author raises the images of potatoes and peas being mashed and mixed with taste bud provoking items like ginger, turmeric and green chilies. She also describes in photographic detail about chapatis cooked over hot fires and buttered and steaked with vegetables, and to tickle the taste bud further, a piece of mango pickle. It is clear that she is nostalgic about the Delhi of her memories, but also affirmative that Delhi has an existence even today outside of her mind in the real world. So children, we have read the chapter and we have discussed all important points in the chapter. Let's discuss few more important things. In this chapter, the writer adds humor and that makes the piece quite interesting. She adds humor when she provides details about two cars that are packed with some 6 adults and 24 children, as well as food for their family picnic. Also in that description, a sense of touch has been stimulated, that how, you know, people form layers, take their seat and form layers, and in their lap again, you know, another layer. So our sense of touch has been stimulated. The author in this chapter has transcended the barrier of time. The city, both old and new, comes alive with her references to the Delhi of the historical past, to the Delhi of her childhood, right down to the time of writing, when she comments on the continuity of a simple habit like taking the same lunch of chapatis and a peas potato side dish with mango pickle and tiffin carriers for lunch. So the author has successfully unified 3 time zones. One of ancient Delhi during Mughal's time, second time zone when the author is a child, and the third time zone when she sits down to write this piece, autobiographical piece. When we read this chapter, we understood that the writer is nostalgic as she recalls fond memories of her secure and happy childhood with the extended family in her grandfather's house in a city that has also been home to rulers from other countries who ruled in the past, and there is a sense of continuity with the present, for even now people take the same kind of food in their tiffins to schools and offices. Children, I hope all of you have understood the chapter well, and if you have any queries or doubts, I will clear it in the online class. Thank you.